The Phlebotomy Textbook, Chapter 10, Special Blood Collection. Certain lab tests require methods that are not part of the routine procedure. These special methods may involve patient preparation, timing of specimen, collection, or other blood collection methods and special handling. There are priorities for blood collections. Routine has the least priority. It would be collected on morning rounds for inpatients or whenever an outpatient shows up. An order with a priority of ASAP is done as soon as possible and before routine orders. A stat order has the highest priority and is usually for emergencies. Samples from the emergency department usually are done stat. Once collected, a stat sample must go directly to the lab and not wait for other samples to be collected. A timed sample must be collected at the specific time ordered and would be collected before an ASAP or routine sample. Collecting timed specimens incorrectly can result in a false elevation or a decreased result. Some tests require fasting, and you must ask the patient if they are fasting. The patient is normally in the basal state in the morning when the patient has been fasting for 8 to 12 hours. If the patient indicates that they are not fasting, you must put this in the record if you collected a non-fasting sample, as it can cause problems for the patient, such as denial of life insurance coverage for an elevated glucose. The lab must complete stat tests within 1 hour of receiving the sample, and ASAP is usually 2 hours. The term turnaround time means how long it takes to complete the collection once ordered for a phlebotomist, or how long it takes to complete testing once a lab tech receives the sample. If a test is ordered as fasting, then the patient should not eat or drink except water for 8 to 12 hours. Tests that require fasting are glucose and lipid panels. A phlebotomist must determine if a patient is fasting. If the patient is designated NPO, this means they can have nothing by mouth, and this means no water too. For timed specimens, the time must be correct. Patients may have taken a medication or drank a high glucose drink. The time must be recorded on the sample. The lab will have multiple samples for the same test and the same patient, so it is important to know which sample was collected when. The glucose tolerance test is one of the most common timed tests for outpatients and is used to determine if the patient has diabetes mellitus or gestational diabetes. This is the American Diabetes Association standard. The 2 hour postprandial glucose means the sample is collected 2 hours after a meal. A fasting sample is also collected before this. Always follow the procedures established at your clinic site or place of work. A glucose tolerance test is scheduled ahead of time. A patient is given instructions to eat a balanced diet for 3 days prior to the test, including carbohydrates. The patient will then fast for 12 hours. A fasting sample of blood will be collected. The patient then drinks a 75-gram glucose drink. Timing starts on the completion of the drink. Maintain the type of collection and tube for each sample to reduce variability. Some medications may interfere with the test. Interfering substances include alcohol, anticonvulsants, aspirin, birth control, blood pressure meds, cortisols, diabetics, diuretics, and estrogen. This chart shows the different types of tests for diabetes mellitus. The oral glucose tolerance test is performed with the 75-gram glucose drink. If the patient has a 2-hour glucose that is greater than 200 milligrams per deciliter, diabetes is diagnosed. For a pregnant patient to evaluate for gestational diabetes, either a 1-step or a 2-step test is completed. The values for each sample are compared to the cutoffs for diagnosis. The lactose tolerance test is not a common test that is performed. It would be a scheduled test. A fasting glucose test is collected. Then the patient is given a standard dose of lactose to drink. After 2 hours, a specimen is collected. If the patient is lactose intolerant, their glucose will not go up more than 20 milligrams per deciliter because the lactose was not digested. Diurnal variation means that the substance or cell counts will vary by the time of day that they are collected. Cortisol, testosterone, estradiol, progesterone, renin, thyroid, stimulating hormone, serum iron, and white blood cell counts will fluctuate noticeably throughout the day. Glucose will vary because of diet. Corticosteroids will be collected between 8 and 10 in the morning or at 1600. Some therapeutic drugs must be monitored closely to ensure they are in the therapeutic range. A trough level should be the lowest level of the drug and is collected right before the drug is given. A peak level is the highest level, and the time varies by specific medication. These must be collected at the correct time. This is a list of some medications that are monitored. Amikacin, digoxin, dilantin, gentamicin, lithium, methotrexate, phenobarbital, theophylline, tobramycin, valproic acid, and vancomycin. A blood culture is used to determine if a patient has bacteria or fungus growing in their blood. These go to the microbiology department. The procedure must be followed exactly to prevent getting normal skin bacteria into the bottle. Contamination with skin bacteria will be a false positive test. Blood cultures can be collected when a fever spikes, stat, before antibiotics are given, or if the patient has a fever without a known cause. Blood culture orders require that 2 bottles be collected, 1 anaerobic bottle and 1 aerobic bottle. The anticoagulant, sodium polyethyl sulfonate, is used because it does not inhibit the growth of bacteria. Samples should be collected before antibiotics are given or a false negative result may occur. Some bottles have a resin that can inactivate antibiotics. Blood cultures are collected in 2 sets. Blood cultures are collected in 2 sets from different locations. Follow your procedures for which tube should be collected first based on the equipment that is used. Because of the air in a wing collection set tubing, collect the aerobic tube first. This is a SteriPath initial specimen diversion device. This means that the portion of blood which is more likely to be contaminated with skin microbes is diverted and does not enter the collection tubes. A similar device is used in blood donation for transfusion to keep bacteria out of the unit of blood. There are a couple of procedures for aseptic preparation for blood culture collection. The two-step procedure uses alcohol followed by iodine, and this procedure should not be used for patients who are allergic to iodine. First, scrub with isopropyl alcohol for 1 minute, followed by concentric circle scrub with iodine starting in the center and going outward. After the procedure, the iodine should be cleaned off of the skin with alcohol as it can irritate the skin. The one-step procedure uses chlorhexidine. Ask the patient if they are allergic. This is not common as an iodine allergy. The top of the bottle should be wiped with alcohol and allowed to dry before a collection of the samples. A general phlebotomist should not collect blood from a vascular access device. Nursing staff can collect blood from these devices, and a phlebotomist can assist. The first 5 milliliters must be discarded. The first 20 milliliters cannot be used for coagulation studies. Discard the first syringe. Second syringe is used for blood cultures. The third syringe is for anticoagulated tubes or for clot tubes, and coagulation tests should come from the last syringe. It is important to note that some patients may have a central venous catheter and it is used for medication administration and for blood collection. A phlebotomist should never handle these and should ask nursing staff to collect the samples from these patients. This is a triple lumen catheter and an implanted port. Do not handle these and ask nursing staff for assistance. Some samples will have special handling requirements that must be followed or the sample will be rejected. If the patient has an order for a cold agglutinin test, the sample must remain warm until the serum is separated from the cells. If cooled, the antibodies will attach to the patient's cells and there will be a false negative or decreased test. Some analyses, such as bilirubin, beta carotene, vitamins A, B6, and B12, folate, and porphyrins, are sensitive to light and must be protected from light by being collected in amber tubes or with tin foil wrapped around the sample. If a specimen requires that it be maintained at cold temperatures, then it is put in wet ice. This is ice that is mixed with a small amount of water. Do not chill samples unless it is required. This slide shows some examples of how you would protect a sample from light. Legal specimens are those that may be used in legal proceedings. These specimens must have documentation of a chain of custody form. A chain of custody tells you who handled the sample and what procedures or testing that the person performed. When performing a legal blood alcohol test, chain of custody is required. The phlebotomist should not use alcohol to cleanse the site. The sample must be filled to capacity and the tube should not be opened prior to testing to prevent evaporation. An underfilled tube could cause a decrease in the alcohol level. A gray top tube can be used to preserve the sample. Molecular tests can be used to identify DNA for forensic reasons, to diagnose different diseases by detecting the DNA or RNA of a virus or bacteria, or for paternity testing. Yellow tubes with acid citrate dextrose preservative can be used. Don't accidentally use the yellow tops that have pointed ends, as those are for urine. Follow your procedure for the correct tube or swab collection. Drug screening can be done for healthcare, employment, or education. Samples require a chain of custody. Urine is the primary sample type. There are many factors that can make the geriatric patient more difficult to collect. Some physical factors include hearing, eyesight, malnutrition, muscle weakness, thin skin, and rolling or collapsing veins. Disease states that can affect the ability to collect patients are Alzheimer's, strokes, arthritis, or tremors. Anxiety and fear can affect any age. Always be kind, respectful, and treat patients with dignity. The geriatric patient, it is important to use small needles with a butterfly. Place tourniquets over clothes to prevent bruising, and don't forget to remove it. If a patient is too cold, they may need warmed up to see the veins well enough. You can apply pressure or wipe with alcohol to see the veins better. Apply pressure to the puncture site for a longer period of time afterwards, and avoid adhesive bandages. Use dermal puncture if necessary. When collecting blood from children, it is useful to enlist the help of the parent if they are not the hysterical type. Notice that the parent is holding down the arm you won't be collecting from. The arm that you are collecting from, as well as has the legs wrapped around to prevent kicking. Children may be very difficult to collect from and can hurt themselves or the phlebotomist if they grab the needle or kick. When collecting blood from a child, a calm parent might be the key to keeping the child calm. If the child does not have good enough veins, then a dermal puncture may be necessary. For infants, use microcollection tubes. For toddlers, distractions help. Talk to children and never say it won't hurt. For teens, treat them like adults. Some children are so wild that they must either be restrained by holding them a local anesthetic can be used. They can be held either vertical or horizontal. This image shows a vertical and horizontal hold for a child. A baby can be wrapped or distracted with a pacifier. The dorsal part of the hand or the back of it can be used when there is not adequate veins in the arm. This may allow you to obtain a better sample than a finger stick will.